Our guest is now here with us. After 3 years of construction work on the 157-kilometer Lagos-Ibadan standard gauge rail line, the project was eventually commissioned last Thursday in Nigeria's commercial capital, Lagos. Undoubtedly, the project is expected to ease the commute and the transportation of goods between two of the country's major cities. But as Nigerians eagerly await the commencement of operations, many continue to raise concerns about the viability of the project, given the federal government's penchant for subsidizing railway services in the country. Also, as part of efforts to tackle insecurity in Nigeria's maritime domain, the Ministry of Transportation has been laying down the framework for an integrated maritime surveillance and security infrastructure, codenamed the Deep Blue Project. And this has been done in partnership with Israeli company Homeland Security International for training and equipment, and the Ministry of Defense, chiefly the Nigerian Navy, in collaboration with other security forces, including the Army, the Air Force, and State Security Service for enforcement. We're here to allay any concerns about the Deep Blue assets already installed, with the breakdown of how the security system is being put together, and the Lagos-Ibadan line, which was largely financed with Chinese loans, is the Minister of Transportation, Honorable Rotimi Amaechi. He'll also be speaking to us on plans to extend the rail line to other parts of the country as originally planned. Welcome to the morning show, Mr. Amaechi. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much.
Well, I guess congratulations to be in order on the commissioning of the Lagos-Ibadan rail line last week by President Muhammadu Buhari. But at the moment, that Lagos-Ibadan rail line, the service that is provided, is really still skeletal. When would the rail line be completed and it will become fully operational? And what are the plans in place for the planned extension of that rail line from Ibadan to Oshogbo, to Ilorin, to Minna, to Abuja, all the way to Kano?
Well, Ruben, coming from you, I should be appreciative of your congratulations, your message to other Nigerians. But then what to say to you is that the rail line has been completed. There's nothing that indicates that it has not been completed. Why the services are still skeletal is because there's what they call communication and signaling. Now, it takes 6 months to know that equipment is in perfect condition. You continue to test the equipment so that you don't have any train accident. So we are moving from two services in a day to four. It will be a gradual progression. I believe that by the end of the year, we'll be doing 16 trips a day, which will be phenomenal.
Yeah, but I asked about the plan for extension all the way to Kano.
Again, I'm happy you're asking that question. I thought we were being criticized for taking the loans. Now everybody's asking, when are you bringing the rail to my village, not even to the city? As soon as we get the Chinese loan, we'll commence the construction of Ibadan to Abuja. But by before the end of this month, we should commence the construction of the Kano Kaduna rail. We've already mobilized the contractors with some funds. We'll fund it initially from our budget, pending when the loan facility or the negotiation for the loan facility has been completed.
Well, speaking of loans, what exactly is your source of funding for the project, and who are the contractors working on it?
A good question. Even when Ruben Abati was speaking, he did say the loan was from the Chinese. I mean, the project was funded from the Chinese loan. And like you know, we're waiting for further negotiation to conclude the negotiation of the Ibadan to Kano. Because we don't have time, COVID or no COVID, we will commence construction with the money funded from the budget between Kano and Kaduna. When the loan negotiation has been completed, we will commence the Ibadan to Abuja. We believe that we should be able to complete the Kano Kaduna one before the end of the government, while the one from Ibadan to Abuja may be completed just some few months after we leave office. But before we leave office, we should have been able to take it to about 80% completion.
Okay, two things. Number one will be, can you just let us know the way it will go from Ibadan to Abuja, the stops, the areas, you know, the knock-on effect on the economy? And secondly, when people do infrastructure like rail, it normally should pay back over a period of time. When is that payment, well, that payback going to start? When are we going to start making, you know, some money at least to service our debt from rail? Is there anything on ground for payback? And let me go to your Kaduna line. A lot of people are complaining, Kaduna to Abuja, that the cost was increased to 3,000 because of COVID and social distancing. Now that there's no more social distancing, a lot of people are back on the trains full time. The cost is still 3,000. You're asking, is that things, when things go up in this country, don't come down at all?
At all, it shouldn't come down. Why should things go up and come down, if you say so? Ruben, now let me be a bit more serious. First is that I've already mentioned on several interviews I've attended that the Ibadan one will go from Ibadan to Oshobo, which is the capital of Osun State. From Oshobo, we'll go to Ilorin to Mina to Abuja. These are state capitals, but to pass other communities like the Jeddah and other areas, and then you get to Mina, and then from Mina to Abuja. Then Abuja one to Kaduna is already constructed, and then to go from Kaduna to Kano, that's that. You're looking at where economic viability. Ruben, I'm not aware of anywhere in the world, please help furnish me with information, where rail lines have been used to pay back such loans. Nowhere, anywhere in the world, anywhere. It's not, if you leave the rail as it is, it's not economically viable in terms of cash. What makes it economic viability is the fact that it provides services for those who are involved in other economic activities, like, for instance, if you manufacture in areas where the rail will pass through, then you can be sure that the rail will provide you transportation and logistics. Now, because of the capacity of the rail to provide logistics and transportation, it impacts heavily on the economy and then reduces cost of transportation, creates employment, and improves on economic activities. That's what will happen. But currently, I'd like to share with you the information that, as we're talking today, we've moved from the 70 million revenue that accrues from Abuja to Kaduna to 350 million as at last month, which means once we remove the operational costs, we have started paying back the loan, even though that will not be the only source of repayment.
Well, Honorable Minister, where China, under its Belt and Road Initiative, has been giving a lot of loans to developing countries, either in Asia or Africa. But there is also this concern about how Chinese loans can be very tricky. What kind of loan security do we have in place in Nigeria to prevent Nigeria from getting into the Zambian situation when Zambia ran out of options for servicing its loans? China has practically taken over the national assets of Zambia, including the National Electricity Company, ZESCO. How do we prevent that from happening here in Nigeria? What plans do we have in terms of security?
Ruben, I'm not aware of your information. What I'm aware of is the fact that when you take the loan, you expect to pay back. And as we're talking today, we're paying back. Ruben, under the regime of President Goodluck Jonathan, the loan for Abuja Kaduna was taken about $500 million. Ruben, as we're talking today, we've paid over $150 million on that loan. And Nigeria has never defaulted when it comes to loan repayment. I don't also expect that we would default in any other loans that we have taken. The loan for Kano, for Ibadan to Kano, is about $1.5 billion. The rest, $500 million, came from our budget. I expect that whatever loan we take, we'll be able to repay. I'm not aware that there's any clause in the loan agreement that hands over any of our national assets to China. Yes, when you default, they may go to court. It depends on the outcome of the court case. So I'm not aware that there's any of the clauses signed by this government or the previous government of President Goodluck Jonathan that mortgaged any of our national assets.
Well, now let's move to maritime security and the Deep Blue project. We watched a brief video on that before we started this conversation on the collaboration between Nigeria and Ghana, which underlines the importance of security of our coastal area. So can you talk about the Deep Blue project and what exactly it serves to give to Nigeria in terms of maritime security?
Now, if you observe before we came, a lot of contractors were contracted to provide security for oil companies in the water. In fact, there was a case between us and OMSL in which OMSL provides about two or three or four boats to the Navy, and they collect 2,500 per vessel for the first day and 1,500 for the second day for about 30 days. In a year, like 2020, they made about $67 million. And when you hand over the security of the country to private individuals, it becomes very challenging. And when we took over, we felt that that's not the responsibility of OMSL and other security, so-called security contractors. We had to get a company to provide us with equipment and training. So the president kindly approved that Navy, the police, the army, the air force should be involved in providing security with those equipments that we have provided. So what the Deep Blue project does for you is that you have about three helicopters, two fixed wings plane, you have about 17 to 18 boats, then you have about two vessels, you have drones. What it does is that it gives you information where these criminals are, those who go and destroy the pipes just because they are looking for oil to bunker. It provides you those information, and you then deter them or you arrest them. That's what it does for you. So we're able to provide security in the coastal region, both on land and on the sea. Now, those who provide the coastal security on land will be the Nigerian Army and the police. And we've provided them with all the necessary tools that they need. We have ammunition, we have vehicles like APCs and all that for patrol by the coast. All that we believe will begin to yield fruit between now and next year.
Minister, please tell me, what's the cost on the rolling stocks of this train? I'd like to know about that, because you keep talking about bringing rolling stock in. What's this cost adding to us? And can't we get to a level where we can start to, you know, do at least some of the refurbishment of some of this rolling stock here, or even production? I mean, if the industries were working, if Ajaokuta and the likes were working, we should be able to do rolling stocks in this country. So what's the cost of that, and when are we going to get to that stage where we start to probably assemble these rolling stocks here?
Well, we've already established a factory. We're establishing a factory at Kajola. With the Chinese, in partnership with the Chinese, where we'll begin to produce coaches, locomotives, and wagons. Currently, they are assembling wagons. They will begin to assemble wagons there by the end of this year. Now, what did we do? We ensured that out of the wagons we're supposed to buy from China, we asked them to bring in only 15% and assemble the rest here in Nigeria. After 5 years, they will move from assemblage to manufacturing or fabrication of those wagons here. We also believe that in that 5 years, they should begin to assemble coaches, if possible, locomotives too. But it's difficult to actually manufacture locomotives where you don't have the necessary tools. But at least we'll start assembling the coaches. The question you ask is as if we should have been doing that by now. But we didn't just wake up by now. This is the first time that the government is beginning to focus attention on railway. And you just can't start 3 years ago. Suddenly, we are beginning to produce or manufacture locomotives and coaches. It will take time. We've sent some of our children to China to study the Chinese technology on railways. We are establishing a transportation university in Daura, which will be managed by the Chinese for 5 years. And train our young men and women. By the time they finish all this training and there is a transfer of technology, we should be able to begin to even lay our own tracks to ensure that we don't continue to import that technology. We then transfer the technology to ourselves and ensure that we learn how to do it ourselves, including the production of the rolling stock. How much is the current rolling stock for Lagos Ibadan? About $500 million. And most of them have come in, apart from the 85% of the locomotives that we are asking them to assemble here. And that will be done before the end of the year. But the rest coaches, locomotives have arrived. They are at Papalanto.
Well, we've been talking about Lagos Ibadan all the way to Kano, Abuja, Kaduna. Is it possible for you to give us a picture of the rail line projects in the south-south and the southeast? I know there is Itakpe to worry, even if recently some funny characters went and removed the rail bars. And I guess that's also something you like to talk about. You know, you construct these rail lines, but they go and remove them. But first, the plan for the south-south and the southeast, and how that part of the country will be linked, and what you are doing about the security of those rail bars that people have been stealing.
Okay, first is the Port Harcourt-Maiduguri will start. We are trying to start Port Harcourt-Maiduguri this June. What is holding us from starting Port Harcourt-Maiduguri this June? What may be holding us from starting Port Harcourt-Maiduguri this June is the approval of a consulting engineer. We are waiting for BPP to conclude their studies. If they give us approval, then we'll go to cabinet. The moment cabinet approves the supervising engineers, which is the consulting engineers, then we'll go to site. Because already we've also mobilized the contractors from our budget, pending when the loan agreement is reached. And with the money we've mobilized the contractors from our budget, they should be able to start from Port Harcourt to Aba. We believe that when we start, before the end of this year, we should be able to get to Aba in terms of rail lane of rail tracks. I don't know about the terminals yet and the signaling, but I'm sure we'll get to Aba by the end of this year with the rail tracks, if not up to Maher. But the Port Harcourt Maiduguri will start this year, this June. I also expect that Kano Maradi will start this June. I didn't say July. What I'll be waiting for funding will be Ibadan to Abuja. But the rest of them will start this June.
Yeah, I talked about the security of those rail lines. Now that we've seen reports of people cutting off the Please go ahead.
I'm impressed by the fact that the cutting off this did not take place in the south side. It took place in Kogi. What they cut off was a siding. It's not a bar. It is actually a track. And imagine if any train was going to the siding, it would have derailed. And once it derails, people would likely die. I have always accepted or supported those who said they should be, anybody who is found destroying any of those rail assets should be tried for manslaughter. The reason is that if you cut off the rail track, it takes about 800 meters for the rail driver to stop a train. So if he suddenly sees that there is no track at any particular place, even if he applies his brake, it will have crossed the track and will derail. If it derails, people will die. So anybody caught doing that, if you ask me, the law should be amended to include the fact that he'll be punished for manslaughter if found culpable by the court. That would be my recommendation. Then what are we doing? We have the Nigerian Railway Police that is going and inspecting from time to time. The next thing we also do is that before we run in a day, we get workers who live in different segments of the rail to inspect and ensure that everything is okay. Where things are not okay, they will alert the management who will look at how to fix whatever that's gone wrong. That's how we discovered all those, the Itakpe Wari one, because if we didn't do that, the train would have possibly gone there and would possibly have derailed. So we think that long-term measure will be to pass a law that punishes those who engage in that act with a listen of manslaughter, while we also think that the police would up their game in tracking and tracing these criminals so that you deter them from participating in such crime. And that thing will be information management and sharing, creating awareness for them to know the danger of such activity. And then finally, the police must first and foremost punish those who buy these drugs. Because if there is no market, then there will be no, if there is no demand, then there will be no supply.
Well, I would say that it's manslaughter, because if you cause an unlawful death of a human being, whether or not you plan to, you ought to be punished. You ought to have the full weight of the law thrown at you. But I want to talk about, speaking of unlawful deaths, the burning issue facing Nigeria today, which is insecurity. We often don't think of the Ministry for Transport when we're talking about insecurity. We think of service chiefs and the police force and what have you. But I want to specifically tie your projects, rail infrastructure, Deep Blue Project, how does it impact that fight against insecurity in Nigeria? Because most of us Nigerians are not seafarers. I want you to explain exactly how it impacts all of us, how it benefits all of us.
Okay, so the first thing is that we are in charge of the security of the water. That's why we're providing the Deep Blue Project. We're not in charge of security of the whole nation. What we are in charge of is the security of the water. So we provided the Deep Blue Project to protect people who engage in water activities. Now, Nigerians make money from everything, whether good or bad. Most Nigerians, when I say Nigerians, I don't mean all Nigerians. Most Nigerians, especially Nigerian elites. So they were making money from insecurity. In fact, some of them were actually causing the insecurity so that they can make more money, especially when it comes to the money they make from the oil companies in the so-called provision of security architecture for them. Now, what we've done with Deep Blue Project is that we will reduce the cost of producing oil in Nigeria, because in producing oil, they also build in the cost of security. So by the time we provide the security in the water, the economy will improve because there will be more money coming into the economy. That's the impact it will have when it comes to the Deep Blue Project. In fact, the Israelis who did that training said, in 6 months to 1 year, if there is no improvement in the economy in terms of how much comes in, both to Mimasa, MPA, and the oil industry, then you could come back to us and we'll be willing to refund. But you know, it's simple mathematics. It is true that the moment you can take away these criminals from the water, the moment you can take away these contractors from the water, then the cost of security, which is borne either by an NPC or by the oil companies, will be part of what will come back to us as income. Then on land, all our coaches, you have armed policemen in all our coaches, and you have enough in any trip we are making to withstand any attack from anybody. That's why all those lies, Kaduna train has been attacked, all lies, none. It can't happen. Why can't it happen? Because we have enough security. That's why it can't happen. The same with Itabewari. You have enough security in those trains, not one policeman, enough to repel any attack. The same will happen when we start running Lagos-Ibadan. As we're currently running two trips, which by yesterday should have started with four trips, you will have enough security inside those trains to withstand any criminal act. That's one assurance we give to Nigerians. Beyond that, I have no role to play with security.
Okay, great insight you're giving. But I have always made a case, and the last time you were here, I made a case for those narrow gauge lines. I mean, some of them were built in 1906, the early days of the British. We used them up to the 70s. Because this rail lines you're building, the government is building, they're building standard gauge. But is it that we're going to abandon those narrow gauge lines? And I'll give you an instance. Take, for instance, the drudgery that it takes you if I'm going from Lagos to Ibadan and I have to go and stop in Omi. When I have a national rail station, the standard gauge line in Dugbe, that is just inside of the town. So is it that we're going to abandon those narrow gauge lines? Are we not going to think of funding for it? That's one. Number two, why is it that the Maradi line, the funding scheme is different? It's not the Chinese that's doing that project. And what kind of rail is it going to be? I mean, I'm hearing stories that it's going to be integrated. The coaches are not going to be just fossil fuel powered. There's going to be some form of electric too. I mean, just expatiate on all of this. And why is that it's a Portuguese company that is doing that? The funding channel is different from the Chinese loan you've been taking for all of this.
Okay. Well, maybe you may wish to know that all our loans are not from China. The loan for Port Harcourt Maiduguri is not from China. We're negotiating with an European bank. The same thing as Kano Maradi, which is also an European bank that may give us the loan. There's nothing different with Maradi. Maradi is the same as any other of our rail track. All those stories you're hearing are rumors, and I don't engage in rumors. It's going to be a diesel powered engine. There is nothing like electric powered engine for us in Nigeria yet until we have sufficient supply of power. You can't engage in electricity when you don't have one or when you don't have enough. Ruben, you know that by the time we took over government, power was at 2,000 megawatts, 2,000 plus megawatts, so nearly 3,000. Even though we have increased it in this government, I don't think we have increased it sufficiently enough to provide for real electricity powered rail services. That won't happen for now until we have sufficient power supply. So what we are currently utilizing is the diesel powered locomotives. So you have the locomotives from take the one we use on the day of launching. In fact, I saw somebody write up that they are refurbished. The aerodynamics of locomotives changes according to the length of the track. If it's intra-city track, you can use those ones that look very beautiful and all that. But when it comes to interstate transportation in rail, you use more rugged ones, and that's the one we just use. And they are not refurbished. They are brand new ones. I went on inspection myself and the Minister for Finance to China to inspect the construction, and we saw the production of those locomotives and coaches. So there is nothing different about Kano Maradi. It is simply just the same as Lagos Ibadan. The only difference between Kano Maradi and Lagos Ibadan is that the funding for Kano Maradi is coming from an European bank, while that of Lagos Ibadan came from the Chinese bank.
Okay, the second question I ask you, what about those narrow gauge lines? What are we doing to them? Are we going to forget them?
Sorry. You know, old age has, I'm no longer as young as I used to be, Ruben. But when it comes to, the narrow gauge, we the contract for Port Harcourt Maiduguri is dual. What we are going to start this June is the total reconstruction of the narrow gauge line. I didn't say rehabilitation, total reconstruction. It means that even where in the past the narrow gauge had avoided either a hill or a valley or whatever, we will bore through that hill to make the line straight, to reduce the length of the track and make it faster for us to get to Maiduguri. Now, so we're rehabilitating Port Harcourt Maiduguri. At the same time, the president has directed that contract be awarded for standard gauge, which will be funded when the next government comes. But the difference between the narrow gauge and the standard gauge is the speed, just the speed. The Lagos Kano narrow gauge is the one we're negotiating with different interest group that want to rehabilitate those ones. That one is for rehabilitation. And when they finish rehabilitating those ones, they will then run it by themselves and make their money and pay themselves back. We've not even commenced negotiation, because the first people we had that negotiation with was the GE. But you know what happened to GE? Now we're talking with different groups now, not just one. We have about three groups that we're talking with. Once we conclude, we'll go back to the president and to cabinet for approval.
So you still have the standard gauge that goes from Lagos to Ibadan to Abuja, then you have the narrow gauge, if people can bring money in, that still goes, you know, through Lagos to Ibadan,
yes,
through Dugbe,
yes,
and to Abuja, and upwards. I'm not sure the narrow gauge got up to Abuja.
Yes.
Okay, quickly, Honorable Minister.
No. It got to Mina to Kaduna, okay. Kaduna to Kano. Just.
Okay, I want to ask you questions about Apapa Port. Just a pack of questions, if we could just take all of them together. The first is, when the president visited last week and he was going to commission a project at the port, all those trailers on the way to Apapa Port suddenly disappeared. The road was free. Was it a good idea to hide the trailers to drive them off the road instead of allowing the president to see the reality, the frustration that people and businesses go through in Apapa. Two, the rail line, Lagos-Ibadan rail line, you talked the other time you were on this program about an extension to the ports, to the Apapa port in particular. What is the guarantee that that will help the problem of congestion in that port, considering the fact that there are other issues, turnaround time, bureaucratic red tape, and all kinds of issues that have made it difficult for every measure not to have worked in that place, including the to-call system. And then finally, still on the ports in Lagos, the suspension of Addis Abala Usman. Many commentators said, you are the person behind it. When is she going to come back from suspension? What is the status of the investigative panel that you reportedly set up?
I'm not hearing Ruben again. Ruben, I'm not hearing you.
No.
Have you finished?
I talked about the Apapa ports. The last point I brought up was Addis Abala Usman and the investigation that's supposed to be going on and when she'll come back. Yes. So I'm done on the Apapa ports.
I'm not aware that I suspended Hadiza. I'm not the president. I don't have such powers. That power rests with the president. And I'm not aware that Hadiza is actually suspended. What happened? I suspect, don't forget I said she wasn't suspended, is she was asked to step aside to enable investigation to be carried out on MPA, not on her. We're investigating MPA. At the conclusion of the investigation, all the reports will be forwarded to the president who will make a determination on the way forward. That's what will happen. When will the panel finish? I'm not aware. I don't know. The panel is now headed by between Ministry of Transport and the Office of the Head of Service. The Office of the Head of Service contributed six persons, including auditors and accountants. And then the Ministry of Transport just brought five. So it's a panel of 11 that's been instituted to investigate activities of MPA from 2016 to the present day. Apart from that, there's not that thing happening. There's not. There's too much noise. Just too much noise. Especially this thing that is talking about Hadiza MP. What is the special interest? That I want to know. But again, I'm not going to address it. Well, it doesn't become sub judice, even though it's not in court. But there's a panel. You don't have to influence the panel. I don't have an opinion over that. And I've told you here that. It is MPA that is under investigation. And the managing director of MPA has just been told to step aside pending when the investigation will be concluded. And when the investigation is concluded, the president will make a determination or determine what happens next. The other question was, and I agree with you, I was laughing when you were asking the question, how did those trucks disappear? I asked that same question. I was in a bus, and I was in the train when I saw it. Everything had disappeared. Even inside the port, that looks like a marketplace, like Oshodi Market, was very well organized. No human beings were found loitering about. No trucks on it. I just said, whoever did this, then we may need to. What it shows you that the problem of the seaport is the problem of efficiency. If they had the capacity in one day, not even one day, one night, because I was there the previous evening. And when I came back in the morning, everything had disappeared. If that can happen in one night, it means that the problem is management, no other thing. And I agree with you that do we need to wait for the president to come before we can be efficient? That's the basic question to answer. And what I did, which will devote to that question you asked, what I did was to have a meeting with the terminal operators. And what I told them on Friday when I met with them is that they have to contribute to the reconstruction of the Apapa seaport. We must rebuild the Apapa seaport, take into cognizance all the issues that we are seeing now that's frustrating the seaport. All those, where do you park the trucks? How many trucks can come into the seaport at what point in time? How can a human being who has no business in the seaport come to the seaport? What is he doing at the seaport? The seaport is a security area. And it's not even me, if I become a former minister, I'm not entitled to go into the seaport unless I have business in the seaport. Now, we're going to partner with customs because they are largely, between them and MPA, they're the operators of the seaport, and see how to arrest this situation. I believe that when we begin to freight cargoes from the seaport through the rail, then we'll reduce some of the challenges that we have at the seaport. That's my belief.
What is your response to critics who say that the Ministry of Transportation is not adhering to the Integrated Development Rail Master Plan, which states that no country in the world is currently building narrow gauge lines anymore, that they are archaic? Standard gauge, as you said, is faster, it's cheaper, more reliable, less accidents, you can get the spare parts. So why is Nigeria, why is your ministry still investing $3 billion in the Port Harcourt-Maiduguri narrow gauge line?
As a journalist, please speak with facts. Just speak with facts. Google your listen and see how many countries, even South Africa, out of their 30,500 narrow gauge rail line, 30,000 is narrow gauge. Check China, check America. They all have narrow gauge. They all operate narrow gauge line. But see, when this information is carried out like this, you incite the Southeast and the South incite the South-South. But it's not correct, completely not correct. And it's abnormal to pass that kind of information. The easiest place to look for that information is just go into Google and say, how many countries do you have in the world? And if you're not up to nearly 20 to 30 countries, call me back.
I asked for your response to critics. I did not pass anything as a fact. And you've given your response
okay.
to your critics.
Then tell the critics to do more studies.
You've just done that.
It's important that they...
Mr. Amaechi, real quickly, I want to know in total, what's the kilometer of all these rail lines all over the country that you're doing, and how much was spent per kilometer? I mean, what does the cost come down to per kilometer? And speaking of the South-South and South-East, would you, you know, fly a presidential flag maybe as a South-South candidate or a South-East candidate? This question never goes away. It hovers around you every single day.
I thought we are here to talk about transport, not about presidential election that will take place in 2023. And I've said this several times to as many persons as possible. Let me do my work. Ruben, allow me to do my work. I have not been sacked by the president, neither have I resigned, nor has our tenure come to an end. I'm currently the Minister for Transportation, and I will continue to discharge that responsibility until such a time that I'm unable to discharge such responsibility again. Please, I don't want to be distracted. That would be the answer to the question. And what was the other question, Ruben, please?
No, total tracks in kilometers. And this is Rufai. This is Rufai you're saying it. Total tracks in kilometers for...
I thought it was Ruben.
No, this is Rufai you're saying it. Total tracks in kilometers for all the tracks across the country. And how much did the cost come down to per kilometer of track you did?
Rufai, I won't be able to know that without the necessary documents. It will require my looking at those papers. Until I do that, I may not be able to answer that question. But I'd like to go back to the last question. Let me go back to the last question. I have narrow gauge railways in Albania. I have narrow gauge railways in Argentina, Australia. Bangladesh, Barbados, Belgium, Bosnia and Herzegovina, Brazil, Bulgaria, Canada, Chile, China, Democratic Republic of Congo, Croatia, Cyprus, Czech Republic, Denmark, Estonia, Finland, France, Germany, Hong Kong, Hungary, India, Ireland, Isle of Man, Italy, Japan, Kazakhstan, Latvia, Libya, Lithuania, Luxembourg. I have in Madagascar, Malawi, Malaysia, Mariana Island, Mexico, Mozambique, North Korea, Nepal, Netherlands, New Zealand, Macedonia, Norway, Pakistan, Poland, Portugal, Romania, Russia, Serbia, Slovakia, Slovenia, South Africa, Spain, Sri Lanka, Suriname, Sweden, Switzerland, Thailand, Tunisia, Turkey, Ukraine, United Kingdom, and United States of America. Have I answered the question?
Those critics will find that handy, but the Nigerian National Rail Plan says no to narrow gauge.
Anyway, Honorable Minister, before we begin to...
You're also wrong. You're also wrong. You simply say that we should rehabilitate the narrow gauge.
Well, Mr. Amaechi, before we wrap up, why does the Ministry of Transportation have a cash-only payment policy? The notice to passengers at Ladiri, cash only, at the various train stations. Why is electronic payment not allowed, not encouraged?
is this
payment Rufai for tickets? Or? Tickets for train.
Is this Rufai? I can't see you. Is it Rufai?
It's Ruben.
Now,
Abati.
You're also wrong. Ruben, you're also wrong.
Okay.
Kaduna Abuja is electronic. You're wrong. Kaduna Abuja is electronic.
Okay, but I'm quoting the Abeokuta station. The Abeokuta station. The one in Ladirin in Abeokuta.
Because we are yet to go to cabinet to seek, we have to advertise for people to bid for electronic ticketing. When we finish the process, we'll go to cabinet. When we get cabinet approval, we commence that. It's not a thing you do immediately.
I see. Well, quickly before we go.
I have a question.
Oh, okay. Please go ahead.
Right. I have a question from a viewer. He's asking, can you ask Minister Amaechi why the Calabar seaport is not functional and what are the plans to make it functional? Also, what is the status of Onitsha and Lokoja inland river ports?
I'm a politician, so I won't give you much answer about Onitsha and Lokoja. The answer I gave in Barrow put me in trouble politically, so I won't give you the response to to Onitsha and Lokoja. But Onitsha, I think they are in the process of they are processing somebody won that, but they're in the process of having to hand it over to him. Lokoja is under construction. That's the best I can tell you. What was the other question you asked? What's happening at Calabar Seaport? Calabar Seaport has to do with dredging, actually. But again, if enough vessels were calling there, maybe we would have been forced to do something quickly. But why it is not being dredged is that if a governor of one of the states in the country took us to court. I think until the court case is over, then we can deal with the issue of dredging.
All right. Well, Minister Amaechi, thank you very much for joining us on the morning show. Thank you very much indeed.